wait a second, stop worrying about the numbers. It's meant to sound like this. Was this song mastered too loud? Has it been damaged? Or is it just a case of artistic intent? Hello. This video was prompted by a Facebook discussion about the Billie Eilish song Zanny, and in particular, comments that it was mastered too loud, especially in the choruses. And someone tagged me in the discussion, which prompted some jokes about the Loudness Police. And I wasn't going to say anything about it because I've had some pushback recently from people saying, stop going on about the loudness wars and telling people that dynamics are always better. Some songs, some genres need that super loud sound to sound right, to work musically. And it's an artistic decision. But I couldn't resist taking a listen to the song, and actually it turned out it's a pretty interesting example with some interesting stuff that I can show you. So I have decided to make a video.
Open up!
Here come the fuzz.
Unfortunately, YouTube won't let me play it to you for copyright reasons. But you can listen to the song yourself. I'll put a link below this video. And there are some things that I can play you, and certainly some things that I can show you that I think you'll find interesting. So let's take a look. So here's the song, and as I mentioned, I can't play it to you, unfortunately, but we can see that it begins with a quietly sung soft introduction, and then at the point where the bass comes in is where the comments are first made. I'll just play that. And there you can see what those comments are saying. The RMS level here, measured on the durometer, is up at zero. The VU meters are pegged. There's also lots of distortion in the sound, and that's what a lot of the comments were about. You know, people asking, why has the loudness been pushed to such an extreme in this case? Also making the observation that this song is going to be turned down by streaming services like YouTube, Spotify, Tidal, Pandora, because they all use normalization to stop us being blasted by very loud songs, which causes lots of complaints. So let's look at that aspect first. What is going to happen to this song online? And we can investigate that using the free loudness penalty website that I set up with Meterplugs. All we need to do is drop the file onto the website and let it calculate, and it will tell us how much the song is going to be turned down by five of the most popular online streaming services. So there we have the results. And I think immediately we can see that there's a bit of a surprise there. YouTube is only going to turn this song down by 1.1 dBs, even though it has an RMS level at some points of zero. Spotify is going to turn it down a bit more. Tidal is going to turn it down quite a lot more, and that's something that I'm going to come back to and talk about in a minute. But let's talk about that RMS value to begin with. YouTube has a reference level of roughly minus 13 RMS. So how is it that a song that has an RMS level of zero in it isn't going to be turned down by 10 or 12 dBs? To try and figure that out, let's take a look at some of the more detailed information about the song. I'm just going to open it up in Isotope RX, and I'm going to use the waveform statistics window to quickly get some information about this file. So immediately we can see that the sample peaks in this is the CD version, are going up to minus 0.27 dB. The true peak levels are not going over zero. Personally, I recommend you keep them at minus one, but it's not uncommon for them to go as high as that for CD releases. But these are the values that we're really interested in here. We can see that the overall integrated loudness is minus 9.4 LUFS, and the maximum short-term loudness is minus 5.7 LUFS, so roughly minus 6 and minus 9. those values are not as high as you might expect from the RMS level. You can see here that the maximum RMS level is actually being registered in RX as being above 0 dB FS, which is pretty extraordinary. The reason for that is something that I've talked about before. RMS is a decent way of evaluating loudness, but it's very sensitive to bass in a way that our ears aren't. And this is another example where the LUFS loudness is giving us a better idea of how loud the song really is. And if we go back to Wavelab, we can see that the same is true if we look at the loudness here, the short-term loudness at the point where I stopped playback, where the RMS meter is showing zero, the LUFS loudness, the short-term LUFS loudness, is showing minus 7.6. So it's really loud, but it's not absurdly loud. So that goes some of the way towards explaining why we're not seeing this song being turned down as much as you might expect from the RMS level online. But I want to come back to the difference here between Spotify and Tidal. They both use approximately minus 14 LUFS for their normalization reference level. In fact, Tidal uses exactly minus 14 LUFS, which makes perfect sense. If the LUFS loudness is minus 9.5 approximately, another 4.5 takes you down to minus 14. So that value is exactly what we would expect. So why is Spotify not turning it down just as much? The answer is that Spotify based their loudness calculations on replay gain as a method of measuring loudness rather than LUFS. And this is one of those cases where the opinions, if you like, of those two different methods are different. So Tidal would turn this song down more than Spotify. And that's one of the reasons that using a rule of thumb like, oh, minus 14 LUFS for all the platforms, or trying to use LUFS estimates for the other streaming services, won't always give you the results that you expect. So if you're interested in the real-world results that you're going to get from the streaming sites, I recommend you use the Loudness Penalty website, or possibly the plugin. We recently made a plugin version of it available. But that's still only half the story, because, okay, we know why the penalties aren't huge, because of the difference between RMS and the way that the streaming services measure loudness. We know why there's a difference between Spotify and Tidal. But the loudest moments of this song are still up at minus 6.5 LUFS. And if we just take Tidal as an example, if the reference level is minus 14, why is this song not being turned down by another 6 or 7 dBs? And the answer, of course, is the contrast in the song. And if I quickly go back to RX and generate a loudness profile, we can see that. You can see that the loudest sections of the song are getting up to minus 7, minus 6 LUFS, as we've already talked about, but the verse sections of the song are much quieter, down at minus 15 or minus 16 LUFS. And that's a big contrast to have between a verse and a chorus, and it's a big contributor to the sound of the song. So this song actually has very wide macro dynamics, longer-term dynamics, contrast between different sections of the song, even though the loudest sections are pushed very hard. But the overall integrated loudness of the song is minus 9.5, so the average level for the song is lower than these very loud sections. And that fact is reflected in the replay gain result that Spotify uses as well. But the people commenting on Facebook weren't only worried about the numbers. The big objection was that when you get to these really loud sections of the song, it sounds distorted as a result. And of course, I can't demonstrate that to you, but it's true. And there were some comments saying that it was back to death magnetic kind of levels, and that this was more evidence that the loudness war really isn't over. But there were also some comments saying, wait a second, stop worrying about the numbers. It's meant to sound like this. The song is intended to sound oppressive and claustrophobic, and the extreme loudness and the very heavy bass suits that perfectly. And in fact, one person posted a link to an interview on MTV where Billie talks about exactly this. And in fact, she says she wanted the contrast between the sexy, smooth verses, which are inspired by Frank Sinatra and Feist, to really contrast with the distorted bass in the choruses. And she says, if you're just sitting in a room and you listen to this song, the chorus kind of throws itself at you, like I'm in their secondhand smoke. And she calls the bass sound crazy, distorted and broken sounding. I just wanted it to feel miserable. And we've got further evidence of that in this interview with Rob Kanelski, who mixed the single, where he says that working with Billie and her brother Rob, their records are so thought out already at every level. Everything is intentional. So, that's case closed, right? Whether we like what we hear or not, that's what was intended. Well, maybe, but there's another detail that I want to look at first, because almost everybody commenting on the way that this song sounds is listening on a streaming service of some kind. And those streaming services are using lossy data encoding for their streaming, which means that whatever the original song sounded like, a large proportion of the data has been thrown away to achieve that data compressed stream. Now, it's really hard to hear clearly what is missing from the streaming version of a song as opposed to the lossless version that you might get from a CD. But one thing we can do is a null test. So here I have the CD version of this song, and I have a version that has come from Spotify, and I have inverted the phase of the left and right channels of this copy. So when we play them back together, you only hear the difference. And I'm assuming that YouTube won't be able to flag this as a copyright infringement. Let's take a listen. If we play that initial huge zero RMS bass drop. So that information is the difference between the PCM version, the lossless version of the file, and Spotify's data compressed version. And it's literally true that if you take this version and add the sound we were just listening to it, you will end up with the streaming version. So it's pretty clear that there is a lot of extra distortion being added into that signal when you listen to it online. And even when we do the same comparison with the premium stream, one thing in particular that I noticed there and listening to the CD master is that there is a lot of distortion that seems to be happening on the vocals as well. And that does suggest to me that that might have happened at the mastering stage rather than the mixing stage, mainly because Billie in the interview is specifically talking about the bass sound, but that is just speculation. Now, we have to be really careful listening to null tests, because the sound we were just listening to is not what you hear when you listen to this song, even when it's been streamed from Spotify or YouTube. But it is true that lossy codecs find it harder to make a clean encode from material that is very dense and has a very high average loudness, which this song does. And there's one more factor to do with streaming loudness that could be contributing to the quality that people hear when they listen to this song back, which is the fact that when a data compressed song is played back without normalization, intersample peaks can be generated, peak levels that are higher than they were in the original file. And those will then generate extra clipping distortion on playback. And we can hear that by nulling this unnormalized capture from Spotify against a normalized playback that has been increased to the same level. Let me play that for you. So what we're hearing there is extra distortion that is going to be added to the file if you choose to listen to the unnormalized version, which lots of people do because they want to get as close as they can to the original sound quality. And if you're thinking to yourself that possibly that distortion doesn't sound like it's the end of the world, I would agree with you. But take a quick listen to this short extract from the first song on the album, Bad Guy, where I've made the same null test. One thing I should say in the interest of balance is that those effects are typically a problem at lower data rates. So on the premium version of Spotify, I wouldn't expect to hear that clipping distortion added, even if you were listening without normalization. On the flip side, if you're listening on Spotify mobile, the data rate is even lower. So you would expect the distortion to be worse, and you would expect the original encoding artifacts to be worse. In fact, it's really ear-opening to compare the mobile stream from something like Spotify or Apple Music with the original lossless audio. So if you're still with me, you should by now have a decent idea of the different factors that people might be criticizing in terms of the sound of this song. There can be artistic decisions, there could be encoding artifacts adding into the mix, and there could potentially be some playback distortion. So where does all this leave us? Was this song mastered too loud? Has it been damaged? Or is it just a case of artistic intent and some people don't like the decisions that were made? Honestly, I'm conflicted about it. I love this album. I love the songs. I love the production. I love the aesthetic. Clearly, I'm not a typical example in Billie Eilish's demographic, but I have a teenage son. He relates to it and loves the album. We can share our enjoyment of it. I love it. It's not mastered super, super loud. It is a couple of dBs, maybe 3 dBs for some songs on the album, louder than I personally would have mastered it. But based on the comments that Billie and the producer have made in their interviews, and by comparing it with other songs on the previous album, which is mastered just as loud, I think we have to conclude that it hasn't been damaged in the mastering process. Has the high loudness contributed to the song? Has it added anything? Honestly, I'm not sure. I mean, we can't tell because we can't hear the original mix. It could be that it sounds exactly as it did in the mixing stage, and the mastering has just balanced the levels between songs and maybe a little bit of gentle limiting here and there. It may be that the mastering has added some of that edge and that grit to the sound. And if so, I'm sure it was done with the artist's approval. Maybe even Billie requested it. Was that the right decision? You could argue, I mean, it certainly hasn't done the sales of the song or the album any harm at all. But actually, research shows that users, listeners, fans don't care about loudness. All that's important to us is the music. So that's not that surprising. Overall, it's quite a mellow sounding album with some very intense moments. For me personally, I wish it had been mastered a couple of dBs quieter. It could have been, I think everybody would have liked it just as much. I don't think it would have been a night and day difference in the sound. Maybe a little bit cleaner. I think the aggression that's in the sound there could have been achieved somewhere else, but that's just my personal opinion. I certainly don't think we can say that it has been poorly mastered or that it inappropriately mastered, because we can be confident that it was done with the artist's approval and that it hasn't been pushed to such a level that damage, if you like, was inevitable. Anything we hear in the sound, I think we have to assume, is a creative decision. That's just my point of view. I'd be fascinated to hear what you think. Let me know in the comments whether you think this is just a step too far, whether you're like me and it's just, well, it's a bit of a shame, because I think if I turn Zanny down by 2.5 dB, it sounds great on my mastering rig, but it just feels like it could have kicked that little bit extra. It would have been played back just as loud online, and I feel if I was mastering, that's an experiment that I would want to do. But I'm also aware that there are going to be pressures, not just from the artists in terms of how the song should sound, but also the record company, maybe A&R people out there. There are a whole load of different places in the artistic chain where the request for loudness could have come from. So there you go. I hope you found that useful and interesting. Head on over to productionadvice.co.uk for more posts and videos like this. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel if you would like to see more videos like this from me. And thanks for listening.